Thank you very much for allowing me to enter your land. I know that the question of land is a very important question. I feel very honored to be here today. And what I will do is just to share a little bit about where I come from and how we managed in South Africa to be where we are as a people. The question for the talk today is, could non-violence be an effective way? And there was a statement that I'm here to answer that question. I would like to pose that question to you because I can only talk about my experience, but we need to grapple with the notion of non-violence together. It doesn't reside in me to know whether that is possible, but very much resides within your hearts to ask that question and find solutions to it. And I'm saying this because I come from a land where there were lots of answers coming from outside, people telling us what we should do with our conflict. But I believe very strongly that it's only the conviction of the will of the people, the values that you hold, that will free you. I come from a land that was devastated by apartheid, which was a process that was meant to separate black people from white people. We were made to sit in pockets of our country and with no rights to be able to move from one place to another. So when you talk about some of your experience today, they speak directly to my experience of where I come from. So in those short words, I'd like to say, I do not know the extent of your suffering because I don't live here, but I know what it is to live in a divided society. I know the pain of being hounded every day. I know the pain of having to carry little pieces of paper to be able to move in my land from one area to another. I know the pain of seeing demolitions of houses that people have built because they have nowhere to go. I know the pain of people coming into my country and telling me that I don't belong. So in South Africa, we lived in a very violent society before we gained our independence in 1994. We're now living in a free society. But some of the pain of the past still lives with us even today. We recognize some of the things that we need to be mindful of. We liberated our people through various means. Some people believed that we should be violent in order to oppose the state. Some people believed that it was important to be non-violent so that we don't destroy our own selves. So when President Nelson Mandela was released from prison and were in a brink of freedom, the world waited with anticipation that we were going to kill our oppressors. The question was, they have oppressed you for such a long time, why don't you just go and kill them? It would be easy, they're like 5%, you're 95%, it will just take a day to destroy them. And we were very clear that we didn't want the blood of our enemies in our hands. I've worked for more than 15 years with victims of violence in my country who have come to me with the pain of suffering of either being imprisoned or being raped. And I know that some of them have said a countless time that I need to find a way to deal with my pain without retaliating, because I don't want to destroy myself. The commission victims were allowed an opportunity to talk about their pain so that that pain was acknowledged by the country. They were to receive reparation after they had told the country what had happened to them. It was a price that they had to pay for the liberation of our leaders. On the other side, they were asked to tell the stories of what they had done to our people. They were to give full disclosure of their action so that they could get amnesty. And so amnesty was conditional, it wasn't blanket. It was on condition that people were to tell what they had done. I think it's important to say also that we got to the Truth Commission process because the nationalist government, which had oppressed us for over 60 years, and the ANC, which had been fighting for our liberation, went to negotiation. And we knew that the negotiation itself was going to be, we had to find a win-win situation. It was going to be, we had to give, let certain things go. The apartheid regime, which oppressed us, and the ANC government, which is now in power, were to make sure that our country didn't dissolve into a bloodshed. Some argue that there was no justice because those who had perpetrated crimes against the people of my land were not locked up in jail afterwards. Some were given amnesty, some were charged for the atrocities they committed. And the question was, where is justice? And so we believe that justice wasn't attained for some people because the perpetrators didn't declare what they had done to harm their people. So they told half-truths. They didn't say exactly what they had done to our people. So for some victims, it was very difficult to meet these people and to think that they're coming for a peaceful transition, but they were not prepared to disclose fully what they had done. Okay. So I think it's important to, the South African situation was a situation where we had to show the world that instead of retaliating, we were able to find a peaceful solution. A peaceful solution involved negotiations between the government of the day and the African National Congress. It was important that the people of South Africa were involved in those negotiations. The ordinary people of the land were given a chance to comment on the negotiation. My belief is that you cannot negotiate peace if you do not get everybody who's affected by an atrocity involved in that negotiation. That take place in closed offices with people who wear ties often don't lead to the liberation of the people. There needs to be an engagement with rural communities, with villages, with everybody to get them on board with this. So I hope for the sake of this land, when the negotiations to broker the peace start, that you all will have a voice to say this is what we want to see for our land. I just want also to say something about young people because I think that is very important for brokering peace. South Africa were very much involved in bringing the government of the day, the apartheid government, to its knees in toppling, in destroying apartheid. I, as a young person in South Africa, suffered greatly from witnessing assassinations in front of me, so I know what that feels like. So I go around in the world bringing a message of peace and non-violence, not because I've read books, but because I've experienced what it means to suffer. So I come around to you knowing that in South Africa we were a people which didn't have hope. I mean, when we're sitting in the height of the apartheid regime, with all that happened to us, we never thought in our wildest dream that our country would be where it is today. I remember after voting in 1994 for the first time in my life, and I became the citizen, the true citizen of my land, I woke up the next day feeling, I don't believe it. You know, I just had to pinch myself to say, is this true? Because 5 years before that point, in the late 80s, when the violence was at its height, I never believed that we'd make the transformation. I'm sure you're sitting in a situation today thinking, where is the light at the end of this tunnel? So you're asking yourself, will you ever live freely in the land of your ancestors? You're asking yourself whether these children will have a fruitful existence in the world. They will grow up to honor who you are as a people. A writer that speaks to me writes about, a singer actually, he writes about children dying before they are born, infested by the grief. It's going to be very difficult for the women of this village to make sure that your children, as they are born, they are not infested by the grief of this land. And sometimes times to counteract that grief, we need to develop hope. We need to have hope in our eyes so that those little ones, when they look at your eyes, they can see that you haven't given up. To give up for me is to let the enemy triumph over you. And we need to avoid that at all costs. Hope is our only salvation. And I know it's difficult when you wake up every day and you look around and there's the devastation all around. But you are people who have got morals and values. Let those morals and values be the guiding principle of where we want to go. I'm really very much moved by your suffering. And as a person coming from a place that has suffered, I believe it is wrong, it is morally wrong to hound and to make people suffer the way you have meant to suffer. I'm encouraged by your presence here, because in the midst of suffering, if you can allow yourself to have a space in your heart to hear about non-violence, there's hope now. I know I stand in front of your wonderful building, which is a school that is supposed to educate your children. Education is one other thing that the oppressor often wants to take away from you because they want to keep you in perpetual servitude. But even so, the vision to have this building is hope itself. Your salvation lies in the salvation of your children. Talking to you yesterday, and one of the things that I think is beautiful is that when you've got values and a culture, that is also a beautiful education that you can give your children. So it's not only formal education, it's about what kind of education they get from home, which is a non-violent education, which is an education towards creativity. Having attained our freedom of South Africa, our next step has been to make sure that the institutions of learning have peace education in them. It's not enough to say never again. It is enough to make sure that we build institutions where peace become an everyday language. I do not know you and I have never met you, but I look at all of you today. My heart is filled with hope. In my country, we have a philosophy that says "Ubuntu, Ubuntu, Ngabantu," which is a philosophy of humanity. It means a person is a person to other people. And the sooner the people of this land realize that there is an interdependence between humanity, the better it will be for them. That philosophy saved us from killing our oppressors. It was very important for us to realize that our oppressors needed to be rehumanized. The debt for that. But we owed it to ourselves to have a transformation that was peaceful, so that our children could live in a peaceful society. The philosophy of Ubuntu led to us being colonized because we welcomed the white settlers when they came into our country. It is the same concept that we use to liberate ourselves from our own oppression.